We saw the noises that enter our RF link either externally or from within our own system. But what about the losses associated to the wave propagation, absorption, and even nonlinear processes? We won't go into details about all of them, but we will consider the primary contributors to losses and see how to include them in our equations. The largest losses, specifically for space applications, are the free space losses. We saw previously that electromagnetic waves drop their intensity quadratically, which means that if you receive a given power flux from an antenna and you go twice as far, you will receive four times less power. So, if we have an antenna which emits with a given power, how do we compute what amount of power will be received by an antenna some distance away? Well, if the radiator was perfectly isotropic, the power density at a distance r would simply be the total power of the isotropic radiator divided by the surface of the sphere. But we were speaking about antennas and focusing electromagnetic waves, so real antennas are not isotropic, and this cannot be true. Well, we only care about the direction in which we are actually emitting, so we can approximate a directive antenna as an isotropic such, which has a total power large enough to give us the same power density in our desired direction. Such an antenna would have to emit more power than our antenna really does, since it will be evenly spread. But we can easily compute its total emission power by demanding that the power in our desired direction remains the same. This equivalent antenna, which is isotropic and would substitute our antenna for a much larger total power input, is called equivalent isotropic radiator. As the name suggests, it is equivalent to ours in terms of power flux at our given direction, but isotropic. Now, one important difference between gain and directivity we should keep in mind is that the gain is always smaller than the directivity due to radiation efficiency factor. But this factor, which relates them, is usually around 0.5 to 1, so they would of course always be on the same order. Given our directive antenna and its gain, we can compute the power flux which will be received at a distance r away from it. And since it will be quadratically smaller with larger values of r, this loss of power flux level is what we call free path losses. Of course, the free space losses are not the only ones we should consider. Especially for higher frequencies, weather conditions can use serious losses of signal power, and so they are essential. In addition to that, polarization mismatch and the pointing deviations can cause some reduction in signal power, and so they should be included as well for a realistic link. The atmospheric attenuation is highly dependent on the satellite's altitude above the horizon and the weather conditions. Depending on the elevation, the atmosphere through which radio signals pass can vary from about 50 to about 200 kilometers. Since the attenuation is usually given as decibels per kilometer, this could be a huge difference. You can see that the plots depend highly on the type of rain measured in millimeters per hour, and the heavy rain, for example, can include losses which are 10 times greater in terms of decibels per kilometer. The main mechanism of attenuation is scattering and absorption of the waves within the droplets. So all these effects are highly dependent on the rain type and drop size as well. But this is a good plot demonstrating the main idea. Also, note that the effects become greater and greater with increasing frequency. The higher the frequency, the less transparent the sky seems to become. So basically, this plot tells you that atmospheric effects should be considered statistically, and depending on the application, we should consider some average value of the attenuation, or perhaps the worst case scenario if the link is with very high priority. As a side effect of interactions with the atmosphere and due to pointing problems, the polarization might also have some mismatch. Since the projection of one field by the direction of another is given by the cosine between the two, and the power is proportional to the square of the field, the power reduction due to the field having different direction is proportional to the square of the cosine between them. Now, considering a wave of random polarization, an elliptical one for example, The average value of the cosine squared given by an integral over its period is simply half of it. So the maximum loss due to polarization mismatch is 2 times reduction, which corresponds to minus 3 dB. Additionally, depending on our antenna pattern, very small deviations from the central lobe direction can cause losses. In our example, given a 10 degrees mismatch in the direction correspond to additional 2 dB, which is quite good since 10 degrees is indeed a lot, but in some cases a steeper maximum may cause problems and so a lower effective gain may be adopted as the gain of the antenna to ensure these are not included as losses later in the calculations of the link budget. So, in summary, we find out about noises and losses. Losses decrease the power of our signal due to its propagation, atmospheric interaction, polarization mismatch, or any other number of reasons, while noises introduce additional signals which are added to our original signal and change it, reducing the amount of useful information that can be extracted. So how do we use all this knowledge on noises and losses, and how do we actually calculate the relevant quality of energy per bit to noise power spectral density ratio? To find out how good our communication system is, you will learn in the next lesson.